Hello, everyone. Right, well, to start this talk, I'm going to kick off, and we're going to talk about fake news. Now, it's a bit of a touchy subject these days, but what happens is, it's a complex subject, something that's deep and quite difficult to understand. And someone comes up with what they think is a general solution for it, or something that could make sense. And then that passes through word of mouth. Then it gets spread across the internet, especially this day and age, through Twitter or other social media outlets. And so we're here today to debug one thing of fake news that you will have come across. And that is that printed circuit board design for electromagnetic compatibility has got nothing to do with voodoo. It has got nothing at all which is mysterious or magical about it. It is just the laws of physics of how pieces of metal are interacting with other pieces of metal. It's got nothing to do with a West African spiritual religion. But if by the end of this course you still do not believe me, then hopefully you will let Harwin and me be your witch doctor. Okay, so when you are going into the design of a product, normally we will think of what's the functionality that you require. So it will be some type of amplification, filtering, processing, for example. And however, when you were young, probably in kindergarten that you call it over here, the very first electronics class that you probably took was that you had a battery and a bulb. And you know that you have to have that wire that goes from the battery to the bulb, but then you knew you had to have a circuit. And that's one thing that we forget as the design of our products gets more complicated. So there's two seeds that I want to plant at the start of this seminar. And that is that we need to think, as well as how in our block diagram we are getting this signal from the input to the output, how are those electrons getting back to the source? And that's a key part of EMC. And the other thing as well is electrons, so pieces of electricity, want to get away from each other. They don't like each other. So if we take those two key principles moving forward, this will help us understand in the next 15 minutes or so. So firstly, a quick thing on antennas. I'm not going to do a 15-week course in the next 12 minutes, but I am going to briefly give an introduction because it will make sense in a minute. So an antenna, a dipole antenna, is basically made up of two pieces of metal. And essentially you end up getting a type of capacitor from it, but we won't go into that. But you end up getting a type of source, an alternating source, and this is able to emit radiation. And this is by there being electrons pulled to one side of it and then oscillated and pulled back the other way. And the trick is to get the source frequency to be proportional, in fact half a wavelength, onto the dipole antenna. And this is very typical. You'll see on the top of rooftops for TV antennas, you'll have other pieces of metal for directivity. All this will make sense in a minute why we're talking about it and why it's linked to EMC shielding. And then a receiving circuit is the same thing, the same principle, but in reverse. So all that happens is you get radiation that gets received by a half wavelength antenna and it gets taken into a receiver circuit. And the key thing to note, if the antenna is not exactly the right half wavelength, then it just means it will be less efficient. And this is a principle that is part of EMC. Now let's say that I've made a widget and it's got a cable coming out of it and it's got a PCB. Now around here, if you would go on your phone and you were gonna see what are, for example, all the different Wi-Fi signals around here, 3G, 4G, coming from the light, you might by accident create a product that is exactly the wrong size that is going to actually act as an antenna. This could actually end up receiving ambient radiation that is going around. So, what's a way that we can get around this? Well, we put enclosures around it. So you have your circuit and you put essentially a metal box going around it. However, it's very important the implementation of this, which is what we're going to talk about. What is very important is that the PCB is grounded correctly to the chassis or to the enclosure. Otherwise, you end up getting almost like a static electricity capacitor around it. However, if I didn't connect it properly, like I did here, what could this mimic? I could have made another antenna. So I've introduced a solution into my product, and I've actually introduced new EMC problems by not paying attention. So this can essentially receive the energy. So this is where something that we manufacture in our company, a cheap way around grounding it to the product. Now, you probably think the easiest way would be to get lots of screws and put it together. But say if you had quite a large product, that could take a lot of time in order to screw it in together, which is why we have these type of spring contacts. These are essentially small surface mount pick and place devices that you can put on top or underneath on your PCB, and that is able to touch onto this enclosure. We also have back shells and metal braiding for the cable, but we're not going to talk about that today. These spring contacts we have in 30 different models available off the shelf that you can sample or buy straight away today with the 2D models, 3D models, and also the test report to go with it to prove that this is a good solution. Because normally an EMC issue is not a key part of your product. You want to solve this as soon as possible. That's why we have this available for you. As well as this, we have this level double-angled contact as well. So if you want to do that grounding effect on the side of your enclosure as well to help increase that EMC performance, you can use this. All of these are available for you to come and touch later on, so please come over and talk to us after I finish this presentation. So that's about external type of radiation. So this is what's around us now. These are the routers that are around here. But what about inside your product? What about if I had like an IoT device that had a Wi-Fi antenna in it? Now, it would be very difficult, or it's difficult to do, to make sure that all of that energy is going outside of my product. And some of it can be captured and actually end up damaging my product. The same could be from a power supply, for example. So you can have your sensitive component, your microchip that's working at high speed. You can have something like a sensor that needs to detect very small signals, and you could overload it by having this transmitting device inside your own product. So how do we get around this? Well, we use a type of shielding. Funnily enough, that's what I'm going to talk about. And this is where you have that radiation, it gets converted into electrons, and as I said, it's important in how those dissipate away from our product, and that's what we're going to talk about. So if I were to look sort of sideways onto this product I have here, so I've got my ground plane in my PCB, a very common way of making a PCB, the substrate in between, and then I'm looking at the chip on top. So what we do is we put a shield over the top of it directly, if that's the part of our circuit or is that the component that we are worried about. And the way that we offer it at Harwin is to use these clips. We have these surface mount pick and place clips, similar to them before, and this means that the can is able to go on top of it, and then alongside some vias that you'll design into your PCB is how we facilitate those electrons to flow away from the circuit. Remember, we want them to get away and they don't like each other, otherwise that's going to cause more EMC problems for us. Now, multi-layer boards is a very common practice, as you know, but also you can get through whole components. And as I said, about trying to get those electrons to dissipate away from our circuit, it's very important that we take this into account. Because essentially a through hole component is disrupting that ground plane. And we're going to explain the importance of this. Say that I've designed this this product here. So not the best circuitry, so I've got a source on one side of it, I've got a signal line that's all wiggly and wobbly, so I'm a very bad design engineer here. It's got to some type of load, then it's going down into the ground plane, and then it's allowing that circuit for the electrons to get back. Now, if it was at low frequencies, say DC, then all of those electrons would use as much space as possible. Remember, they want to get away from each other. They don't want to be touching it. But do you know what happens at high frequencies? What actually happens? You end up getting this. So this is where you'll have the forward current, which is going across the top of your circuit. And then even though it has all that space on the ground plane, the electrons choose to take a path directly underneath the original forward path. Now, why would that happen? Well, let's take a piece of wire, which you'll probably remember from physics class when you were younger. If I had a piece of wire, and then if I had my right-hand rule on it, so I've got the direction that the current is going in, and then I have a magnetic field that is caused just by having this current going through it. And this creates, and if you had a loop, this is essentially an inductor. An inductor is a loop of wire with current flowing through it, creating a magnetic field. So if I was to look at a snapshot of this, here I have a current going into the board, coming out of it, and I end up getting this type of magnetic field that's going around it. Now if I had a larger loop of wire, I've got more of a surface area. And that means, therefore, you can have a larger amount of magnetic field that is created from the same amount of current. So I've converted that energy from current into a magnetic field. That's a loss. That's something we want to avoid in our circuit. So let's go back to the original example. So I've simplified it here, I've got a straight line. And then say I put a through-hole component in exactly the wrong place, or say that I've borrowed a little bit of the ground plane just to reroute a track around and make use of that. So let's imagine I've snipped a bit out of it. Let's zoom in here. So what's going to happen? I'm going to have that forward current going over the top of that gap that I've just got, and the electrons trying to take the least path of resistance, as we know, or in this case, the least path of impedance. They're trying to follow that line, and instead they have to route themselves around this slit that I've just created. So what happens from this? You end up creating a magnetic field. You've created a loop. You have put an inductor into your circuit just by borrowing a little bit of that ground plane. This is why that we try and avoid this type of practice. So if I had here, so you can see I've got two lines, they are the same length. So if I had it either as a big loop of wire, if I were to simply put those lines together, I would actually end up getting less of a loss. That is what would actually happen, because you're not allowing that space for that magnetic field to be formed. This is why our EMC solutions that we have are surface mount. They are not through hole. It's to try and avoid this type of scenario from happening. So the idea is that you have the clips that are involved in holding these cans that I'll go into in a minute, and you're able to not have to worry about this type of effect happening. But what about if, because out on the market, there are these through-hole type of shields that exist. Let's zoom in a little bit. Let's have a look what could be happening here. Well, so here you can see I've got my ground plane, I've got the top of my shield and the pin going through the other end. Well, let's go back to something you might have studied before called Kirchhoff's current rule. What happens with this? You get a current. When it gets to a junction, it splits into two different currents and then goes back and joins together. So what's the difference between this circuit here and where I have a source, which is from that radiation, which is turned into electrons, gone into my shield, and then it gets to a T-junction and it splits. The current can't go any further down the pin, so it reflects back. Does this remind anyone of anything? It could turn into an antenna. So here I have introduced a product into my circuit to try and help with preventing EMC problems, and I can actually introduce EMC problems by using this type of component. That's why at Harwin we do not have this type of shield. This is why that we have these surface mount clips. They are packaged in tape and reel, which means that when you are manufacturing your product, the same as the spring contacts I mentioned earlier on, so in the same machine where your resistors and your capacitors and your microchips are being added on the pick and place machine, you can also have the clips that are available as well. These essentially hold onto the can by these type of fingers that are sitting up. They're available in various different sizes, so it depends on the application that you're looking for. So if you have a static device, you might want to have a lower retention force. If you have something that's going to be under harsh environments, you might want a higher retention force, which I will talk about in a minute. We also have these off-the-shelf shield cans. Now, I'll be honest, the vast majority of our customers manufacture their own shield can, because normally you get the arty person who's designing their widget wants it to be looking something pretty, and then the poor PCB design engineer has to somehow fit their PCB around this product. And so, therefore, normally they manufacture their own. However, what we can do is speed up that process, because if you want to make your own can, it takes 6 weeks with the tooling charge, etc. But this time you can just use something that's available and move on with this problem quickly. But it depends on your application and what you're trying to build. Now you might say, okay, but clips holding onto a can, I'm designing a motor, it's going to be under high vibration. Well, you know, surely these aren't going to be good enough. Well, several years ago, we took the weakest can that we had and we tested it for vibration. We took 12 pieces of it, we tested to the EIA standards, which are similar to the mill standards. And then we found that by coincidence, we had one failure happening on one of the cans on one of the tests. And this is for our weakest force that we have. So therefore, we know what the limit is on the weakest component that we have. However, we have many more that have higher retention forces. And you can come over here in a minute and you can see the difference. So one of them you can take off with your hand quite easy, the other you'll need a screwdriver to ping underneath it. So again, it depends on what you're trying to look for. Do you want to do regular servicing to your device? If so, it's best to have a weaker retention force. If it's going to be permanently put on in a couple of seconds, no need to solder it, which could all get messy when you're doing it. Instead, you can use a higher retention force. So it depends what you are trying to solve. We also have this type of design kit as well. So if you're during a prototyping stage and you think, right, I could have EMC issues here, I'm trying to stop this having a problem. Well, it's essentially a sheet of metal. It's over there in the cabinet. You can have a look at it. And essentially, it's 5 millimeters spaced, and you're able to chop it out into the right shape that you want. Okay, it's not going to be exactly the right size. That's not going to be what you use in your end manufacturing. But at least it's a little design tool that can help you along with these clips. Okay, so thank you very much, everyone. Please come over to the stand and ask us in a minute if you've got any more questions. This is my email. You can find me on LinkedIn. I regularly post articles about EMC or other designs and technology that's going on. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Hopefully it's been interesting for you. Thank you very much.